More and more children are out of school, but parents don't want math learning to stop. They're turning to Mathnasium at home. Real-time math instruction tailored to your child's exact educational needs. It's the same face-to-face live instruction used in our centers for over 15 years, now on a computer. Your child can keep their math skills sharp, catch up, or soar ahead, from home or anywhere with an internet connection. To learn if Mathnasium at home is right for your child, visit mathnasium.com/at home. Mathnasium at home, changing lives through math.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Mathnasium Schoolhouse. I hope you guys had a great weekend. I know that I did. Want to give everyone a moment to get our worksheet downloaded for today and let you know that we're going to be talking about estimation. So this is part one of our two-part series on estimation. Go ahead and download that worksheet. It should be in the link for the video or in the comments as well. And while everybody gets that going, go ahead and let me know where you're from, what grade you're in, if you go to Mathnasium. If you have a minute, go ahead and share this video as well. We would really appreciate that too, just to make sure that everyone can watch along and learn with us today. All right. So, let's go ahead and just get some basic things down about estimation. So we want to estimate or use our best reasoning to determine the length of the string in inches. And we can see that we have 1 inch marked off and then we have a couple of other markings there as well. So how long do we think that this string is in inches? What are our thoughts here? If I told you that this would be 2, let's make this a little bit smaller, and then 3. How long do we think this string is altogether? If I have maybe 2 more markings there, I would say, yeah, exactly. It's 5 inches. Nice job. So what about the length of our pencil here? How long do we think the length of our pencil is? Yeah, very good. I would say that it's about 4 inches. Let's do a couple more of these. Let's go ahead and estimate the number of pennies that can be placed side by side along this line. How many pennies do we think we can get side by side along this line? Well, let's see. Draw a couple more on there. That's about halfway. A couple of those are a little big. If my drawings were better, right? We would estimate that we could get about 8 pennies onto that line, right? Okay. So for number 4, I can see I've got a circle, I've got a rectangle, and I want to know how many circles would fit into our rectangle here. So if we get another circle here, these are not very good drawings today. That one's better. We can see that I can get 2 for the height of my rectangle. And what about for the width? 2, 3, 4, 5. So how many altogether would I have? If I have 2 rows of 5 or 5 rows of 2, very good, I could get 10. So a little warm up there with our estimation skills. Now looking at this number line, and just so that everybody knows, we're on page 2 of our worksheet here. So we can see we've got the number 0 and the number is 10 marked on our number line, but everything else is missing. You see that everything else on our number line is missing, and I've got, if I were to go about halfway here, give ourselves a jumping off point, what's halfway between 0 and 10? Halfway between 0 and 10 would be 5, so very good. I see a couple answers here. I do believe that this would be 2 and 4. Very good. And that would make sense if my dotted line there is 5. So then if I move forward, it looks like these are about the same distance apart. This one might be a little bit further. This one is probably 6. And my last one here, I saw a couple people said 8. But I think this one is closer to 10 than my 2 was to 0. So if it's not 8, and we know it's not 10 because 10 is already marked, my estimation would be that that would be the number 9. All right, let's go ahead and do number 2. So now I'm going from 0 to 20. And again, my halfway point here is going to be 10. So if we're looking in the middle, that's going to be 10. What do we think? What do we think our numbers are? Well, this point here looks like it's halfway between 0 and 10. So we'll go ahead and estimate that that's going to be 5. So if that's 5, halfway between 0 and 5 is 2.5. This one's pretty close to that, so I would say that that's 2. I don't think it's close enough to be 1. So then after 10, it's pretty close, a little bit closer than 2 spaces. I would say that that's going to be 11. So that makes this probably 13. If we're looking at this point being halfway between 10 and 20, would be 15. All right, so now we're going between 80 and 100. So what's the halfway point? Looks like I've got a halfway point marked here. What number is halfway between 80 and 100? Very good, that would be 90. So I don't know if I'm looking in between those two points. Here I've got 84. And 86, most likely, if I'm going to count by twos, I probably got, this would be 82, this would be 88. So then moving all the way to our last point here, we're looking at a little bit further than halfway between 90 and 100, so it wouldn't be 95, it would be 96. Okay. Few more of these working with negative numbers now, so we can see we're between negative 10 and 0. So our halfway point between negative 10 and 0 would be negative 5, right? So what's between negative 5 and negative 10? A little bit more than halfway would be negative 8. And then I've got here negative 3 and negative 2. We said those dots are fairly close together, not quite close enough to be negative 1. So I'm going to go ahead and estimate that that's negative 3 and negative 2. Another one here. Again, looking at my halfway point, that would be negative 10. Very close here to 0 would be negative 1. And fairly close, not as close as negative 1 is to 0. I'm going to estimate that that's negative 18. And between those two points, between negative 18 and negative 10, will be negative 14. Last one here for our warm-up on estimation. What is between negative 15 and negative 25? What do we think? Very good, negative 20. Nice job. So if that's negative 20, what's my next point here to the left? A little less than halfway between negative 20 and negative 25. Would be negative 22. Going to the right now. What do we think? This is probably 18 and 17. I would think that 16 would be here and 19 would be there. Very good. Okay. We're going to go ahead and move on here. I think we had some duplicate pages there. That's my mistake. So let's talk about rounding. This is going to be important when we look at estimation with operations. So with multiplication, division, addition, or subtraction, we're going to need to know how to round numbers in order to get the easiest estimation. So this number here, it looks like it cut off a little bit. So it is, and I'll go ahead and rewrite it, it's 241 is between which two numbers? Well, I know it can't be A because 241 is larger than both of those numbers, so it can't be between those two. Is it between 200 and 300? Well, it's greater than 200, and it's less than 300, so I would say yes, it would be B. And 241 is closest to, well, I know it's much bigger than 100, and it's much smaller than 400. So now we just have to decide, is it closer to 200 or is it closer to 300? Well, I know that 250 is the halfway point between 200 and 300, and 241 is smaller than 250, so that means it's closer to 200. Nice job. So that means that 241 rounded to the nearest 100, that means we're rounding it to the closest hundreds place, would be 200, or B as well. So looking at number 4, it's bigger than both of those numbers, same for B, and same for C. So that means it must be D, and that makes sense because 488 is between 400 and 500. Now, it can't be closer to 100 or 200. We just have to decide, is it closer to 500 or to 400? We'll use our halfway point again. We know that it's bigger than 450, which means it must be closer to 500. Nice job. A couple more of these. 488 rounded to the nearest 100 then is also 500. Good job. 333, getting smaller now, looking at tens places, would be A. 333 is between 330 and 340. But which one is it closest to? We know it can't be A or C. Is it closer to 330 or is it closer to 340? Very good. B. Nice job. So rounding off 333 to the nearest 10 would be 330. So now that we've got practice with rounding and a little bit of a review in estimation, I want you guys to tell me what 96 plus 97 plus 98 plus 99 equals about what number. And when we see equals about, or the word about, we know that we're going to be rounding and estimating. So what could I round all of those numbers to easily get a good estimation? Well, I think all of those numbers are very, very close to the number 100. So what if I asked you what 100 plus 100 plus 100 is? Exactly, 400. And now I want to know, would that number be higher or lower than the real answer? Would it be higher or lower than our real answer? What do we think? Would it be higher or lower? So I've rounded all of my numbers up. That means I'm making my sum larger. If the sum is larger, that means that my estimation is going to be higher than my actual answer. Very good. All right, so let's go ahead and do number two. 990 is really close to the number 1,000. 1,020 is also very close to the number 1,000. 498 is close to what hundreds number? 500. And 530 is also close to 500. So, if we add that all up, 1,000 and 1,000 is 2,000. And I have 2,500, 3,000 would be my estimation. So is that going to be higher or lower than the real answer? For the first one, I rounded up 10. For the second one, I rounded down 20. For my third number, 498, I only rounded up 2. For my second number, my second 500, my fourth number, I rounded down 30. So am I going to be higher or lower than my original number? What do we think? Higher or lower? Lower. Very good. Very good. All right. So, if I were to ask you conceptually, so we don't have a numerical solution for this question, but I want to know, is an estimate an exact answer to a question? Is an estimate an exact answer to a question? For any of those problems that we just did we get the exact answer? No, we did not. We did not get an exact answer, right? So what does it mean to estimate? What does it mean to estimate? An answer to a question. We are using our best knowledge to approximate the solution. So we want to think about that word approximate. So we are making an approximate calculation, we'll say. We're making an approximate calculation. Alright, so number five. If Jason earns $32 each day, he's earned $292. His sister thought that he worked for 11 days. Could she be correct? So would Jason's sister correct in thinking that he earned $292, making $32 a day for 11 days. Well, let's see. 32 is very close to 30, so he's pretty close to making $30 a day. And 292, I would say, is pretty close to $300. So what do we think? Could she be correct? Well, yeah, very good. I would say no, Right, exactly. Because he, by her logic of working for 11 days, would have made more money than what he actually made. Good job. Right. Very good. Okay. Let's do a little bit more rounding practice, maybe. Yeah, let's do some more rounding practice. So 34 is between which two tens numbers? And I would say it is closest to 30. Very nice. So, 68 is between which two tens numbers? It's between 60 and 70. Which one is it closer to? Is 68 closer to 60 or closer to 70? All right, very good. It's closer to 70. All right, and 99 is very close to which two tens numbers? 90, and what's our next tens number? 100, and 99 is much closer to 100 than it is to 90. All right, so let's round these off to the nearest 10. 41 rounded to the nearest 10 would be 40. 38 rounded to the nearest 10, 40. 65 closer to 60 or 70. Yeah, very good. 70. We always want to round up in this case. Which means 56 would be rounded to 60. 24 would be rounded to 20. 17 would also be rounded to 20. It's closer to 20 than it is to 10. 25 would be rounded to 30. 93 would be rounded to 90. And 82 would be rounded to 80. Very good. All right, I think we all get rounding pretty good. So we're going to go ahead and move on to some more estimation problems. So we're going to skip ahead a couple pages here in our work along sheet. But if you need some more practice with rounding, you have some there to work with. So that's great. So let's go ahead and look at some word problems with estimation. So we know that tickets to a concert cost $49.25 each. So what's the best estimate for our cost of four tickets? So the first thing we need to do is make that $49.25 a little bit easier to work with, right? So I'm going to round that up to 50. I think that 50 is a nice, easy number to work with. And we're looking for four tickets. So $50 four times would be what? Yeah, very good. $200. And is that going to be higher or lower than our real cost? So we rounded $49.25 up. So that means that it's going to be higher than our real cost. We've inflated the value of the tickets by rounding up, so that means that our estimation is higher than the actual cost. So let's look at number two. The package of paper costs $10.75. So what's the best estimate, or about how much does it cost for three packages of paper? We're going to do the same thing in this case, and we're going to round up to $11. Because I think that we can handle, oh, no, we're not. Based on our answers, we can't do that. We're going to round down to 10. 10's easier to work with. We could have stuck with 11, but that wouldn't have given us one of the answers that's available on our worksheet here. So if I've got $10 for three packages, that's closest to $30. And this time, we rounded down to $10. So that means that our estimate is lower. Our estimate is lower. If we had stuck with $11, like we originally thought, our estimate would have been what? We would have rounded up to 11, so our estimate would have been higher. But because this is multiple choice, I don't see 33 as any of my options there, so I knew that I needed to, for this problem, round down. But good job. All right, number three, a bag of coffee beans weighs about 212 pounds. That is a lot of coffee. What's the best estimate for the weight of six bags of coffee? Best estimate for six bags of coffee. What do we think? Well, we can round this to 200. And six bags of coffee. Six is really close to five. We'll make this a really easy problem to work with for now. Then we can talk about some other things. So if I've got about 200 pounds in each bag of coffee, and I've got about five bags, then I would have approximately 1,000 pounds of coffee. And that would be lower or higher. Well, I rounded my 212 down to 200, and I also rounded my 6 down to 5, so we would be much lower, much lower. Now, we could have, again, just left our original estimation of 200. That's fine. That makes it much easier to work with, but we could have done 206 times. I think that we can handle that, and that would have given us maybe a more accurate estimation, right? Because we're only changing one of our numbers. So we can always consider that as well. Again, multiple choice wouldn't have worked out here, but would have been a little bit closer to our actual answer to the problem. All right. When doing her homework, Maria usually spends between 20 and 30 minutes on each subject. Tonight she has homework in four subjects, so what's the best estimate of time it will take her to finish her homework? What's the best estimate of time it will take Maria to finish her homework? So again, we know she's got four subjects. And she typically spends 20 and 30 minutes on her homework. So our best estimate is going to be what? What do we think? So if we're working with time, 30 minutes is half an hour, and I know that four halves makes two wholes, and I think that's pretty easy to work with. So let's go with 30 minutes. Four times, it's going to be 2 hours. You could also, and I see this as a couple answers, we could have gone between 20 and 30 and went with 25 minutes, which would have given us 100 minutes, right? And 100 minutes is an hour and 40 minutes. So again, maybe a little bit closer, but not one of our options here. So we're going to stick with using the half an hour estimation for each subject. So is that going to be higher or lower? Well, we rounded, we used the highest amount for each subject, right? We used our 30 minutes, so it would be higher. Job. All right. Number five, a bridge can hold a maximum of 16,000 pounds. Can a car weighing 3,249 pounds, a van weighing 3,500 pounds, and a truck weighing 5,875 pounds be on the bridge at the same time? So are all of those vehicles going to keep the bridge from collapsing, or do they weigh too much? So we know we've got 16,000 pounds as our maximum weight capacity. So our car is really close to 3,000 pounds. Our van, we can leave that alone. I think working with 3,500 is okay for you guys. And our 5,875 pounds is very close to 6,000 pounds. So if I add all those up, is it more, less than, or equal to 16,000? What do you think? What do we think? That leaves us with 12,500 pounds, which is well less than our 16,000 pounds. So we are good to go. We're good. We'll make it. We're fine. Yes, they can be on the bridge at the same time. And our answer can just be solved with our math problem there, or just by saying that our estimation is much lower than the weight capacity of the bridge. So if you guys enjoyed this lesson today, I really encourage you to reach out to your local Mathnasium. Go ahead and find out what they can do for you. The style of teaching at Mathnasium is a little bit different. It's more one-on-one with an instructor, where they're going to personalize everything exactly to your needs. So I definitely encourage you, if you enjoyed this, to reach out to your local Mathnasium. Otherwise, I'll see you guys tomorrow in our second part of our estimation series. We'll be doing some more word problems, some more problem-solving techniques with estimation. We'll probably start with a little bit of a review again. So again, I hope you guys enjoyed this. Share this video if you did. Looking forward to seeing you tomorrow on our second video in estimation series. Have a good one.
It's afternoons that seem to be the most hectic for us, so it was much more convenient when we found Mathnasium at home.
All right, so how do we do half of five? I think one of the best things about at home is that it really feels like you're almost at home with the student in their house teaching them.
I'm in my comfort zone.
You can just ask for help and the instructor will come right to you.
With Mathnasium at home, I know that they're getting the help that they need.
Awesome, great job.
Mathnasium, changing lives through math.